conference room and talk about the impact of Littman on Asian American community. It's a useful and valuable publication, so please help yourself. And tonight, we are very, very fortunate to have two eminent researchers from the CUNY, CUNY office to talk about Asian American students, the social and demographic profiles of the students that attend the City University of New York. As you know, the City University of New York has roughly about 14%, I believe so, maybe
that's
right. Probably gonna correct me. 14% of them is probably Asian Americans. And so to have the two researchers talk about it is very, very fortunate for us. David Crook is the University Dean of Institutional Research and Assessment at the CUNY Central Office. He directs the Office of Institutional Research and Analysis and collects and analyzes the CUNY student data for decision support and reporting. And Dr. Cheryl Littman is the Manager of Research in the Office of Institutional Research, and she oversees projects involving the analysis and reporting of the student data. Before coming to CUNY, she was a research analyst for the Chicago Public Schools. So please welcome Dr. Littman and Dean Crook.
Thank you very much, Dr. Tam. It's really a pleasure to hear you refer to us, and I'm very flattered, as eminent researchers. And frankly, it's, you know, most of our time, unfortunately, is spent doing data collection and answering the questions of bureaucrats and less esteemed activities than actual research. I'll stand here for a minute and back to back. So it's a privilege to have a chance to actually speak to a group like this and talk and share some of the real research that we've had a chance to do. And we're also privileged because in that we sit on a veritable mountain of data at the CUNY Central Office, and most of it we don't have a chance to actually look at in any depth. The source of our data is multiple. It comes from regular collections that we maintain with the CUNY colleges. Every college sends us data every semester. It allows us to track the performance of our students at every college. Basically, almost every kind of student that's identifiable with our data, we can track from semester to semester, college to college. And we also do a large amount, actually larger now than in the past, of survey research. And the difference between survey research that we do and what any of the institutional researchers at the colleges can do is that we do the whole system all at once. And so what that means is we can compare college to college the demographic and social characteristics and the attitudes and satisfaction levels of all of the students at each college, and compare college to college, and look for patterns. So you'll see some of the benefits of some of the fruits of that research here. What we'll be presenting to you tonight is a combination of results from registration data, the first set of data that I mentioned that we collect from the registrars, and results from a survey that we just completed in spring of 2002. This was a survey of all the undergraduates at CUNY. So graduate students aren't included, non-degree students are not included, but undergraduate students at all of the 17 undergraduate institutions of CUNY are in this survey. We completed it in April of 2002. We sampled 1,000 students at every campus, 2,000 at the comprehensive colleges, John Jay, Tech, Medgar Evers, and College of Staten Island. We call them comprehensive because they both offer the associate level and the baccalaureate level degree there. Double sampled those schools. Overall, we had a response rate of 31%. Because response rates nowadays are getting lower and lower as people become resistant to opening their mail and answering telephone calls, we're pretty proud of that response rate. 7 years ago when we did the last survey like this in 1995, I think we had a 36% response rate with much less effort. This time we badgered our poor students relentlessly with follow-up postcards and sending them a second copy of the survey. And we heard back actually that we were overdoing it from some of the institutional research directors in the field, and the word trickled out that from some students that when would we stop bothering them with our postcards? Then we wait for results to get a representative response. And so we're pretty confident that, especially when we look at system-wide estimates, that we're getting very, very close to the actual values in the population because the sample is so large altogether. So with that, I'll start to talk to you a little bit about the results. Before I go any further, let me just mention that Cheryl Littman deserves the credit for all the data analysis that you're about to see and the presentation. So what you're seeing tonight is really her work. I get to talk about part of it, but I just wanted to give her credit for doing all this work.
As Dr. Tam mentioned, the percentage of CUNY undergraduates who are Asian is 14.2%. And that in itself is a story. When I first started at CUNY back in the late 80s, that percentage was much smaller. And I think back in the early 80s, when the university first started collecting this information, it was closer to, it was about 4%, the percentage of the total undergraduate population. I just want to back up for a second and give you the structure of what we're going to do tonight. We'll start by, in the introduction, giving you a feel for where Asian students are enrolled at CUNY and what kinds of majors they're enrolled in, what kinds of degrees they pursue, and so forth. So that's the introduction. Then Cheryl will give you some of the salient demographic characteristics of the Asian population. Then we'll move to some of the highlights of social interaction questions that we asked. I should say that the survey covered a broad array of topics. We asked about student satisfaction with services and their usage and their access to technology, interaction with each other and with faculty, several demographic questions. So you'll see some of the findings here, but we're really only giving you a fairly small subset of the findings that are available in this survey, which, by the way, is linked to the registration data so that we can cross-tabulate the survey responses by all of the information that's available to us in the data files. So the social experiences section will be a small part of, where we reflect just a few of the questions in the survey. And then Cheryl will finish with a discussion of the academic preparation of our students in the high schools, and then how they are able to parlay that preparation into what you could call, it's fair to say, exceptional academic performance at CUNY. So. Just as I mentioned before, those of you I know are all, most of you are familiar with CUNY. I know that a lot of people, I guess, get used to going to their own college and don't think of just how large a system this is. It's, as I mentioned before, 17 undergraduate institutions spread across all five boroughs. Total of 208,000 students now. The university's been growing pretty rapidly the last several years. The enrollment at CUNY hasn't been this high since 1994, when it was 212,000. And before that, the enrollment wasn't as high as that since the 1970s. So we're almost back on a par with enrollment in those days. So we'll go to the next one. So here is the racial composition of our undergraduates. You see the 14.2% Asian. The largest group are African Americans, blacks 31.5, Hispanics, whites are next. What's remarkable is the diversity at CUNY and how equal the major groups are in terms of just the absolute size. Of course, it differs from campus to campus. Graph here translates those numbers, the 14.2% overall of Asians into actual numbers by college. And you can see right now, the smallest numbers are in Megar Evers, Hostos, Bronx, Lehman, up in the Bronx. And the largest number is down there at the bottom, Baruch, almost 4,000 Asian students, followed by Hunter, LaGuardia, and Queens. It's not surprising that the Queens colleges have such large numbers, since, as we'll see, the borough that almost the most Asian students live in is Queens. So, those colleges are convenient for them, but they also offer curricula, I think, that are attractive to Asian students. These numbers are large, and I think they on the previous screen we saw that they add up to the total? Let's go back. Yeah, to 24,000 Asian students across the whole system, and that's an all-time record. I don't think that number has ever been as high as it is right now. So here are those numbers, the enrollment numbers that we just saw by college, translated into percentages of the undergraduate student body. So almost 30% of the Baruch undergraduate body now is Asian. These are color-coded. You can see the legend up there, top right. The largest percentage-wise representation there is at the senior colleges on the whole. I mean, there are more senior colleges toward the bottom of that pyramid than toward the top. Gives you the gender breakdown for Asian students. Overall, 53% of our Asian students are female, and that compares to other students. That percentage is 64%. Asian students are more likely to be male than our other students. And I think that we can maybe have a discussion afterward that would touch on some of these themes that come out, but. That's one way that the Asian population at CUNY is different than overall. The graph shows you for each bar what's the gender distribution percent male and female by college, and so you can see that there's some differences here where a college offers, I think, especially strong technical offerings like New York City Tech. There, the percentage male is even a little higher than average, it probably is true of some of the other colleges as well. City College, for instance, just above it there in the middle, fairly even a higher percent male than overall. As you can see, the Asian students are focused, they're concentrated in bachelor's degrees. 56% are pursuing a bachelor's degree, 38% are pursuing associate degrees. As I mentioned before, that percentage pursuing bachelor's degrees is higher for Asian students than it is for other students. And more of them are at the senior colleges and pursuing bachelor's degrees. The thin slices at the top have to do with non-degree students and certificates. Certificates at CUNY right now are, I think, an opportunity waiting to happen. We don't have very many certificates, and we really should be offering more programs at that level. The non-degree represents 5% of the population. Makes it clear that by far and away, as I said before, Queens is where our Asian students live. 52% of them live there. This information, by the way, that I've just been giving you comes from our registration files, not from the survey. So we'll be getting into the survey results a little bit later. I don't have the number in front of me now for comparison purposes. Let me see.
26%
Yeah, I live in Queens.
Yeah.
Yeah, so for non-Asian students, the percentage living in Queens is half that, 52%, not quite half. So that just shows you, you know, where the concentration is. And I believe the percentages for Asian students in all the other areas are a little lower than for non-Asian students. Okay. This tells you where they're studying, what their majors are, you can see from that by far and away, you know, the most popular two sets of majors are business and management, 31%. And computer and information science is 21%. Asian students are much more likely than other students to major in those two areas. I had written down some comparison numbers here, but I can't. It's I think it
20%. Business management is still a very popular major among the non-Asian population, but only 20% are studying business and management. And computer and information sciences is really ranked something like fifth in the non-Asian population as opposed to second as it is here.
Yeah, it's 7.2% for non-Asians are in computer and information sciences. So the Asian students are three times more likely to be in computer and information sciences than non-Asian students.
Did you break it out at some point by country of origin?
We can. We haven't done that yet. It's
by major, is that what you're asking? Country
yeah.
of origin by major.
By major.
Yeah, it's something we can do almost anything. That's one of the advantages of having sitting on top of so much data. But we won't have that here for you tonight. This shows the same display for community college students. And again, the heavy emphasis on business and commerce technologies, mostly business related, and data processing is 26.3% of all of the majors. And again, those two slices for Asian students are much much thicker than for non-Asian students. Do you have the numbers for
that? Business and commerce, 22% for the non-Asian population as compared to that 26%.
So that's not such a big difference, but the data processing.
Data processing is only 11% in the non-Asian population.
So,
are these fraternal degrees or are these for transfer students intending to transfer or do you have them for?
Well, you know, that terminal degree is sort of an interesting concept in that even the students that are majoring in what are commonly thought of as terminal degrees go on to transfer at fairly high rates. Our students transfer without the degree, with the degree. Of course, the transfer rates are lower without the degree, and they are lower in the so-called vocational or what's often called terminal degrees. They're higher in the arts and sciences, but there's no such thing as a true terminal degree. Yeah.
How many of the students going to grad school who are Asians?
How many are going to grad school?
I've gone to grad, like percentage of going to grad school. I have those percentage.
You know, that's something that we should be looking at, but we haven't had a chance to do that yet either. A fairly high percentage of our students do go to our own master's programs. Much harder to get good information about graduate programs outside CUNY. The only way that we could get that would be by asking students, doing a survey of them, you know, when they get to their senior year and ask them what they plan to do. And that information is, you know, plans and actual behavior are a little bit different. This is the type of high school that they've attended, and the overwhelming majority went to New York City Department of Education schools, 70.5%. Again, this number is also quite a bit higher than for other students. For other students, that's only 60%. Asian students are more likely than other students to come from foreign high schools. That's 14.1%. Only 4.2% come from the New York City private schools. That number is about probably half. For other students, it's about 12% from the private schools. So,
yes.
Yeah, private and parochial are in that category. So, And that's it. All right, over to Cheryl.
Okay. I'm going to talk a little bit about the demographics of the Asian undergraduate population. One interesting thing is that, well, those of you who know about the CUNY population in general, you often hear things like CUNY students are not like typical college students. They tend to be older, working, some supporting families, that kind of thing. But it's interesting, the Asian undergraduate population is more like traditional college students. The average age of Asian undergraduates is 23 years compared to 25 overall. Just want to point out one thing as we're going through these statistics. In some cases, we're making comparisons between Asian students and other students, meaning non-Asian students. And in some cases, we're making comparisons between Asian students and everybody, including Asian students. So we use the term overall in that case. Sometimes we're not able to break out statistics for non-Asians. So just to keep aware of that, 25 is influenced by the 23 years of Asian. If we took them out, that might even be a little bit higher for non-Asians. So just for some context in these overall statistics.
Can you also break it out by community college and community?
We can. We haven't for this presentation, but it's possible, and I'll just write that down. So it's something we can look to do. In addition, Asian students tend to be more financially dependent on their parents. 44% are fully financially dependent compared to 31% overall. That item, by the way, is something we asked in our survey.
And this is now we're first getting into the results of the survey.
Right, some of these are. 80% of Asian undergraduates are single, have never been married, compared with 73% of the overall undergraduate population. Fewer supporting children, only 8% versus 22%. 42% don't work at all versus 30%. And 3/4 attend classes or courses full-time, compared to only about a little bit less than 2/3 for the overall population.
And we should point out that bottom bullet is related to all the bullets preceding it. Because you know, when you're supporting children or you're married and you have work obligations, it means that you are less able to attend full-time because of role conflict. Just too many things to do all at once.
Did your research data break any of the, or have you sufficient data to break this out by different Asian ethnicities? Because obviously South Asians and East Asians are a whole different kind of fish, one would think.
Well, some of them we can. The information that comes from registration data, it's possible to break out in those categories because we have enough students in those categories to make the valid estimates. But when we get to the survey data, because we've only surveyed a sample of students, if we break the groups too fine, we don't have enough to make reliable estimates in those groups.
So we could break it out for Chinese students and for Indian students, because those are the two largest groups under the heading of Asian. But once you get into the groups smaller than that, the survey estimates get to be a little unreliable.
In the survey, how many are Asians? You did a survey. It was beyond, you did it of all students, or is it just Asian students?
It was of all students, all undergraduate students.
And what percentage, what number are Asians?
It would be close to the 14% in the overall population. I don't have the exact one percentage, but we weighted the response to back to the to so that it resembled the total population as closely as we could. So it would be close to the 14%.
14 of 5,000.
A little over 6,000 responses. So I think we're talking somewhere around 700%. I just kind of did that quickly, but
so 700
Asian students responding in that survey.
That's the 42% do not, or that's a revelation. From personal knowledge, you thought a higher percentage do work.
anecdotally, it doesn't feel
do that hours per week?
Hours per week.
How long was your break?
We had several breaks, zero hours, and then 1 to 5, 6 to 10, 11 to 20, and over 20.
Okay, and this do not work, does that mean zero or does that?
Zero.
That means zero. Dean Crook mentioned before when we showed the racial ethnic composition of all of CUNY, how diverse CUNY is. And another interesting thing, this is probably not news to anybody here, but is how diverse the Asian population at CUNY is. And I think you find the same thing with, for example, the Hispanic population and the Black population and, of course, the white population as well. You know, we tend to group people into these broad categories, and I think this is kind of the point that you were getting at before with breaking these out by breaking these out a little finer.
Yeah.
But anyway, you can see here some of these statistics show a little bit about the diversity among the Asian population. 82% of Asian students are foreign-born compared with 46% of other students, non-Asian students. 88% have a native language other than English, the largest percentage speaking Chinese, Korean next, Bengali, Cantonese, Japanese and Urdu. You can see the breakouts there. Then there are a number of other languages represented just by much smaller percentages. Is there a question?
Yeah, but Cantonese is also Chinese.
Yes. Interesting. Is it correct that Cantonese is spoken primarily in Hong Kong? Is that not correct?
No.
No? Okay.
No.
The reason why I was wondering that is because when you see some of the other statistics, like country of birth or country of identity, students will select Hong Kong and China, or China, I should say. And so people are making the distinction. So there are certain, when students indicate on their application what language, what their native language is, they are selecting Chinese as one of the choices rather than some dialect of Chinese. And some are selecting Cantonese, and I'm not very good with Asian language.
I think the reason that kind of is put down Hong Kong because Hong Kong was and the British control.
Right, when they lived there, of course, that would.
I think to be identified as Cantonese in this data, the student would have had to have written that into the application.
Okay.
And if,
yeah, but actually, when we say the language, and my colleagues, some students put down Mandarin.
Mm-hmm.
So I put three categories of Chinese. Chinese put in general, and Cantonese, mm-hmm. Sitting group, and Mandarin.
Mm-hmm.
However, they specify their language, they spoke language.
Right, okay, so we should really put those two together, so 33% are speaking some dialect of Chinese or some language. Yes?
When you say 80% are students foreign-born, are they a foreign student or are they a naturalized citizen or permanent resident?
Good question. Unfortunately, I don't have that data right here. They're not all foreign students in the sense that they're not all here on student visas. But for this presentation, we can get information on what percentage, at least at the time of entry, were citizens. We might even have current information on whether they're citizens or what status they have at this time.
Do you have comparable statistics of this sort for previous periods, going back some, you know, 15, 20 years, we didn't compare these numbers with the situation at some time or not?
We can begin to do some of that for two previous points in time. 1989, we did a survey like this, and 1995, and in both of those, I believe we asked, I don't think we asked native language, but we did get at Asian ancestry, so that we could look at how the ancestry within the Asian population may have changed between 1989 and now, and I believe we know the percent foreign-born, but we didn't always ask the questions the same way. And the other limitation is that before 1992, the questions about ancestry and language were not part of the CUNY application. And so some of this information comes from that. So we don't have that before 1992.
actually legal for you to ask about immigrant status, immigration status in the survey?
When you say immigration status, do you mean citizenship status?
In a survey.
Yeah, this information was not asked on the survey. The citizenship status, well, actually, it doesn't appear here, but it is collected as a part of the application process to CUNY.
So you can ask.
Yeah. Yeah, now it's, of course, I mean, it's getting to be more and more of an issue at CUNY with the immigration and natural, with the Patriot Act that requires the university to report student status to the INS on a regular basis. So that's another set of issues.
I would predict that the Japanese in this set here, to go back to the earlier question of naturalized or foreign students, the Japanese would be foreign students overwhelmingly, and all others would be naturalized overwhelmingly. Mm-hmm. The others being immigrants and Japanese, unlike students from a lot of other countries, coming in here for undergraduate education.
Mm-hmm. That's something we'll keep an eye on. I did notice looking at the data that students who the Asian students at the community colleges are much more likely to have graduated from foreign high schools than at the senior colleges. And I don't know if that squares with your knowledge of the university, but that's another pattern that I noticed.
How do you create the points, the questions? Do you have a sense of, how do you come up with what points, what ideas to come up with the statistical information? Do you create your own, do you have a board? Do you have someone who relates to you?
Well, when we designed the student experience survey, we did a lot of consultation, starting with the directors of institutional research to find out what they were interested in knowing. The provost had a hand. The faculty senate, read drafts of this, frankly, there's a fair amount of theft in survey research too. What we do is look at what other colleges have asked about students to get a sense of. What other colleges' concerns are, and so all of this goes into a process of formulating a survey. Just keep in mind what you've been seeing here is a mix, though, of registration data, and it's been mostly that so far, and not so much of the survey research results.
So the information that you're seeing here are questions that are asked on the application, as opposed to a survey.
Oh, so then when you said overall that not necessarily the survey.
Overall may be from the survey data, yeah. Not necessarily. It's just a comparison point where either we're comparing it to everybody or to non-Asians.
Yeah, whether it's from the survey or from the registration data. We know about everybody on both the registration data and the survey.
You wouldn't have flagged that when you released this, by having asked us for something new for you.
Mm-hmm.
So people know
you're talking
about different populations.
Okay.
Yeah, I think from my experience, what you just asked, it seems the foreign students tend to attend the community college, and I think one of the reasons is the language requirement.
Uh-huh.
Now, you cannot go to senior college unless you mm-hmm. pass the language.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's interesting.
Yes,
that makes sense.
I'm just going to talk a little bit more about this one. Just in terms of comparison, and also as a further testimony to the diversity, the top native languages, the top-ranked native languages of non-Asian students include, well, English, of course, Spanish, Russian, Creole, French, Polish, and Greek. In the top, let's see, what did I just name? I think I named seven. In the top seven, none of these Asian languages appear. Probably the Chinese would appear in the top 10, but it just shows the depth of the diversity across the university that all of these different language groups are represented. And then just to finish off this slide, almost 90% of the Asian undergraduates are bilingual. They're speaking a language other than English at home, and are dealing in English in their coursework primarily. And then another interesting finding is that 47% of Asian students are first generation to attend college. And that's not so different from CUNY overall. You can see 46%.
Other standards.
But as in terms of the bilingual or speaking a language other than English at home, you can see there's a huge difference, 90% versus 54% for non-Asians. And a little bit more on the demographics. Household income of Asian students seems to be slightly lower than for the total population. 54% of Asian students are living in households with incomes below 25,000, and it's a little bit lower than that for the overall population, 50%. This slide is showing the country of identity or country of ancestry for the Asian undergraduate population. These are for students enrolled in fall 2001. Probably just based on language, you would have guessed that, you know, which countries are most highly represented. China, 23%, India, 11%, South Korea, and then there's where Hong Kong is listed as separate. Bangladesh, Philippines, Japan, and then some of the other countries. And then a number of other countries, I don't have the breakout of the other category, but 8% represented by other Asian countries.
Okay. So at this point, we'll be reporting results that are entirely derived from the student experience survey. And remember that we asked a number of questions about how much different student perceptions of the extent to which they interact with their fellow students, faculty members, some questions that were designed to get to look at the perceptions of you know, how much at home they feel on their campus. And these were some differences from some additional differences turned up. Asian students are a little bit more likely than other students to work with fellow students on class assignments. 88% work with others during class at least occasionally, compared to 84% overall. Now that's probably statistically significant, but not by much given our sample. So it's really a fairly close number. 74% work with others outside of class at least occasionally. What's interesting in these numbers that's not shown here is that when you look at the percentage who say they do so regularly or very often, it's a pretty small percentage, both for Asian students and non-Asian students. Our students, I think, are less likely than other students at other institutions to work collaboratively, you know, because they're commuter students. They come, they go to class, they don't spend a lot of time around the campus. They have all these other role obligations that we saw learned about earlier. So their time is really pressed, and so they tend to come, take their classes, get on the subway, go home, and take care of some of their other obligations, or go to work. Then.
Go ahead. I think that these findings here, in my recollection, are very close to the numbers the way things were a decade ago.
Uh-huh. I wouldn't be surprised. We're still the same kind of institution.
But being out of place is feeling that there's a different values. What maybe that reflects is that we're talking a new wave. Each new freshman who has been here 3 years, 7 years, however many years, represents this thing. Whereas whatever the institution does, mm-hmm. doesn't show up. over a decade.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So making people more
comfortable. You're
that puzzling because to talk about Asian students that way is to simply ignore the fact that there are some fundamental differences within Asian cultures from South Asia, East Asia, and so on. And, you know, to say, well, they feel out of place. Yeah, but who cares? Because we don't have a sense of what that may mean if we simply talk about Asian students in some undifferentiated way.
Well, we would like to get into that sort of detail too at some point. We haven't for this presentation, but the data, I'm sure that, you know, when the Institute has a chance to go into it a little bit more thoroughly, or when we do, you'll be able to explore some of that. As I said before, we can go into some of the major subgroups. I believe if you look at Asians, if you look at Indians, Chinese students, and South Korean students, you're down to, in those second two groups, about 70 students. That's enough to give you a very rough feel for what might be going on at that level. But below those major groups, you really can't do a lot of investigation. Yes.
What about the difference between first generation Americans and second generation Americans, and further when it comes to Asians? Mm-hmm. Is there a difference?
I'm sure there would be. Yeah, I'm sure there would be. And you know, maybe Frank, you have some a sense of some of those differences too between the first and the second generation students.
In the last item, more like a feel that their peers, their non-Asian peers, or their peers.
I think the peers in the question would probably be interpreted as every other student on campus, and then it, you know,
including
other Asians. I mean, it doesn't ask them to distinguish between to make this observation by race. It just asks them, you know, compared to your peers, to other students at campus, how you know, do you feel? It asks them to what extent do they agree with the statement that other students at their campus have different values than theirs, and Asian students were more likely to agree that other students had different values than they did. And Frank is quite right, by the way, that when you go back to 1995 and 1989, those bottom two bullets have been a consistent finding that the Asian students have consistently had higher ratings on these questions than other students, and there are differences by campus too. So, you know, it may have something to do with the efforts of the student affairs people, the density of interaction, maybe the proportions of the different groups that are available, or the particular groups. A lot of factors could be feeding these kinds of perceptions, and there's research to be done on that. I think there's probably even a paper to be written there.
So the non-Asian students, and the last one, the non-Asian students would be even less than 55%, correct?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Since the Asians are included overall?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, as this says, Asian students are a little less likely to interact with faculty than other students. I wouldn't put a lot of emphasis on a difference between 18 and 22%. It's just a very slight difference. But the important finding here is just how few students of any race talk with the faculty. And I think that's partly because so many of our faculty are part-timers, and you know, they're like the students. They're rushing from campus to campus, trying to make a living. They don't have office hours. A lot of the faculty here.
When do you hang out anyway?
Well, that's good.
Quite a few of them.
But it runs against you know, what they need to do to make a living. And then we asked a series of questions about use of, you know, how students use their time, you know, this. There were very few differences here between Asian students and other students. I think the interest is just what the numbers look like for everybody. Our students don't spend an inordinate amount of time preparing for classes, as you can see for this. 37% said that they, of Asian students, 38% of overall, you know, said that they spend less than 5 hours a week preparing for class. And when you up it to 10 hours, then you're up to 72% overall of everybody, you know, spends less, 10 hours or less preparing for class a week. Attending class, they spend a little more time doing that. You add up the 1% for less than an hour to the 10% for 1 to 5. You're up to about a third who spend less than 10 hours, up to 10 hours a week attending classes. This is just, by the way, for full-time students. We've limited this analysis to those students.
What's the majority of the full-time Asian students?
Full-time, right. And the comparisons are to full-time students.
Yeah. Yeah. Go ahead. Okay, this is how much time our students spend commuting. Asian students are a little more likely than others to live close to campus, at least in terms of commuting time. 11% live closer, spend less than an hour a week, I guess this is, right?
Yes.
traveling to and from campus compared to 6% overall. The interesting finding is just, I think, how much time our students spend mostly on the subways. If you look at, 47, about half of them spend more than 6 hours a week on the commuting to work. And it's interesting, the university got a request recently from the Corporation Council for information on the commuting patterns of our students in case the MTA workers went on strike. We're looking for evidence of how much of an impact, they were looking for evidence of how much of an impact a strike would have in different areas of the city, and we happen to have this information. A subway strike would put a real dent in the ability of our students to get to campus.
In this category, is that also full-time or full-time?
Yeah,
full-time,
this is
yes.
All for full-time. Only full-time students are represented here. And then leisure, again, this was an interesting finding that it speaks to the fact that our students are a busy bunch and have other things going on in their lives than their studies at CUNY. 72% overall and 7% of Asian students spend absolutely no time on campus, this is what they say, in extracurricular activities or activities outside of class. They take their classes and they don't take part in the organized extracurricular activities, the organizations, the athletics, and so on that might be available there. The student affairs deans were interested in that finding. They get a sense of what they're up against in terms of planning activities for students. And then we asked a question about email there in the bottom. What percentage, how much time they spend on using email and the internet. Asian students are spend a little bit more time doing that. 36% of them said that they spend 6 or more hours a week sending email, surfing, or chatting on the web, compared to 28% overall. We asked a series of questions about access to technology, because the technology gap has been a theme that we've been interested in over the years at CUNY. The difference between relatively well-to-do students and poorer students in their access to computing in the form of a home computer and access to labs on campus. And for a long time, there was a real difference, a big difference between community college students and senior college students in terms of access to technology that we were concerned about. But in the last couple of years, the percentage of students who have access to a computer at home has just skyrocketed upward approaching 100%. It was 89% overall. 95% of Asian undergraduates have said they have access to a computer at home. We made a distinction between having a PC and having a connection to the internet. one of the implications for this is that the potential there is for online communication through the internet with our students in general. CUNY is lagging way behind other institutions around the country in terms of how much we've integrated computers into the classrooms, email into communication among our students and with the faculty. There's a tremendous potential to communicate that way because of the of those numbers there, the high percentage of our students that have access to that are online.
Has that information been made available to college administrators? Because this case has been made by faculty at my college, and the main stumbling block is the vice president, I think, who is now academic affairs.
Which college
doesn't really know how to use a computer herself.
It has been presented. I gave a presentation of the entire range of technology findings to the what's known as the IT Steering Committee for the university, which is has a representative from every college who's the chief IT officer, and they were very interested in this. Believe
me. Preaching to the choir.
The faculty have begun to hear this. I've also presented to the student affairs deans, and as we disseminate these results, they'll percolate down. So, but they're not. By the way, the IT people aren't all converted. They're not all agreed to, you know, the common approach about this, and they didn't realize that the numbers of students who had home computers was so high. They were very interested in these results.
Yeah. All of these bullets, the last bullet on the previous slide, show a pattern of greater use, or sometimes marginal pattern, consistent, greater use by Asian students of technology. What I was wondering if you might do in the future is do regression with these and with the fact that you have a very high percentage in tech majors.
I was going to make that point. I think,
and then see what seems to be driving all the aspects of the pattern.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's an excellent point. I was going to say something like that too, that we saw that the Asians were more likely to be majoring in data processing at the community colleges and computer and information sciences at the senior colleges. So and those classes, those majors, do more group work in class using computers. They're more likely to do work in labs at the school. So it all has implications for the usage of computers.
You might want to ask another question as well. And that's how many of them have had success with it. I found in my own classes that there are lots of people who have computers and use them, but some are far more successful than used to be. Mm-hmm. And I wonder if that might very well show up in these numbers of students.
When you say success, yeah. What do you mean?
Getting a student can actually figure out how to use Turnitin.com.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, what was the second part of that sentence?
You able to use Turnitin.com. Are you familiar with it?
No, I'm not.
Turnitin.com is an email, is a legitimate address. Go look at what they're doing, and it's amazing. My Asian students seem to be more likely to master the relatively modest intricacy than
in future surveys. We do have the ability to vary some of the questions and to explore certain themes a little more deeply, and so we're interested to hear suggestions like this. So I guess why don't we go to the next
one?
Okay.
One thing you might be
I'm on the website for CUNY.
One thing you might be interested in finding out in your survey is ask them what percent of their professors use technology in their classroom.
Yeah. I think I've been especially interested in the percentage of our students who communicate with faculty by email. And there, I think there's an issue of logistics, just getting the faculty to make their email address available, organizing it so that the faculty have access to the student email addresses, and which email address, the one that that the college gave the student or the faculty member that they don't use versus the one that they really use at home. There are a lot of issues, but if the university got a little better organized, I think that we could do a better job of communicating using email. This is what I was talking about. These numbers are lower than national benchmarks, only 25% of our students say that they communicate with their classmates. Well, this is about an assignment, using email. These numbers are a little distorted in that we asked about how often they do, and so this 25% and the 32% of Asian students reflects the percentage who said often or very often. Occasionally was a choice, and when you bring the occasionallys in, that percentage goes up quite a bit. So it's not quite as bleak as those numbers would imply. But very relatively few, only 1 in 5 said that they communicate often or very often with a professor using email. Only 14% of Asians, 12% overall, said that they handed an assignment using email very, very often or often. And again, probably these are in maybe in the more technical areas. More questions about how our students use technology. Asian students are more likely to go online to look for information about services at the college, registration, testing, other college-related information. So this goes to your point about facility with the computer, differences in facility with it. And then Asian students are also more likely than others to look at a course web page. This also means that they are more likely to take courses that have web pages. And there are not all that many, even now, courses that are being offered that integrate web technology. The colleges are making a push to train faculty in Blackboard and some of the other software that they would need to integrate web technology into classes. But it's still a work in progress.
Okay, and the last part of our presentation this evening is giving some information about the academic preparation and performance of undergraduates at CUNY. I think what you'll find in the next several slides is, really supports the notion that strong preparation in high school leads to better success in college. Now, of course, we didn't do research to directly link those two things, but I think what you'll see in the patterns in the next couple of slides will show that. And I think this is really where you see some good news about how well Asian students at CUNY are doing. Academic preparation of first-time freshmen, just to keep in mind, the prior statistics were primarily about undergraduate population overall. Here we're talking about just the first-time freshmen. 31% of Asian freshmen have a high school grade point average of at least 85%, at least 85, compared with 18% of the non-Asian population.
We should point out that this goes across both the community colleges and the senior colleges. It's the entire spectrum of freshmen.
Right. Looking just at the senior colleges, though, slightly higher percentage have a high school grade point average of at least 85, and 15% have a high school GPA of at least 90. So. They're coming in very well prepared, at least, the top third. And 18% of Asian freshmen in the senior colleges scored at least 1,100 on the SAT. And that would be just for the senior colleges, to point that out, versus 12% of the non-Asian population. Some points about course taking patterns. The first, the top part of this comes from the survey, the student experience survey. In general, Asian undergraduates take more courses per semester than their peers. Full-time students, 46% are taking at least 5 courses versus 39% of the overall population. And for part-time students, more than half are taking at least 3 courses versus just a little over maybe a third of the overall population. 26% of Asian first-time freshmen are enrolled in ESL courses compared with 10% overall, which obviously if you factor in that a number of that not everybody from the overall population is coming from outside this country. Makes sense that you'd find such a big difference.
I'm surprised that you said that.
I'm sorry?
Your previous slide showed that most students are being very well prepared when they walk in the door. You got a group of strong scores on standard achievement tests and so on. And yet you say that 26% of the ESL course.
Yeah, that's a good question. I'll qualify this. These statistics on this slide would include only students who graduated from domestic high schools. Sorry, I didn't mention that before. From foreign students, we don't necessarily have the SAT and high school grade point average information. It doesn't always translate. Thanks for bringing that up. Once students enroll in CUNY, Asian students tend to do a little bit better in their courses than non-Asian students. It's a slight difference. Seniors in bachelor's programs have an average cumulative GPA of 2.9 versus 2.8 for non-Asians. And then we looked at sophomores in associate programs, and there the GPA is on average 2.9 versus 2.7.
Is that surprising given their better preparation?
No, that's exactly the point I was trying to make in the beginning of this part, is that this is where, even though we're not doing research that directly links cause and effect here, the pattern is exactly what we would expect. If they're coming in stronger, then we would expect them to be doing better. We also looked at some retention rates for Asian students and also the non-Asian freshman cohort. Retention is defined as students who start as freshmen in a particular fall term. We look to see who's still enrolled the following fall, so an entire year later. So as you can see, for the full-time, first-time freshman and baccalaureate programs, for Asian students, you see that that retention rate is higher than for non-Asians, and it's also increasing pretty steadily, though it's increasing for non-Asians as well, which is a good sign overall. Same for freshmen and associate programs, although the pattern is a little bit less clear. It starts out a little higher, 98, dips down and starts to pick up again in the later terms. We haven't presented data here for the fall 2001 cohort, though we do have some preliminary data, and it does show that this upward trend in retention rates is continuing for all students.
How did you measure that? If they are enrolled in one semester and then they're still there the next fall?
The next fall. And one thing I should point out is we don't look to see if they're enrolled in the intervening spring. So it is possible that some of these students stopped out for a semester, but a common measure of the success rates of students is this fall to fall retention. We use it because some of the agencies that we report to ask for information defined this way.
Yeah, the magnitude of the difference between Asians and other students at the associate programs is really a pretty large difference there. We can do that with our data. We didn't do that here.
Sorry.
We can tell you that the graduation rates in usually on average in the AAAS programs are a little bit lower than they are in the AAAS programs.
And of course, if students are staying in school, that means they're accumulating credits faster. So of course we would expect then to follow that up with higher graduation rates, which is what you find here when you compare Asian students to non-Asian students. And again, if you look at the trend over the last couple of years, you see that we're doing a better job of graduating our students. They're doing a better job. Students are doing a better job.
Our university.
I should say it the other way around. Of earning a degree in a 6-year time span. We do have data that shows four-year rates and five-year rates, but again, as I mentioned before, six-year is kind of a typical indicator that, that we report for other purposes, so it's useful for comparison here.
These are students who have gone, who have entered CUNY and remained in CUNY for whatever it is to complete the program.
Right, and again, it doesn't consider stopouts, so we're not, we're kind of looking at the beginning point and the end point, and we're not really following them in the in-between, so
given,
some of them...
Given Mayor Giuliani's 120 points, we can figure that there's something like that with the six-year schedule. What I'm more intrigued with is, have you given any thought to the very perplexing issue, the one that I hear most often from people in my college administration, of the bodies who disappear through transfers that somehow never get plotted?
We've given done quite a bit of research on that. One of the resources that we have available to us is data from the National Student Clearinghouse, which is the organization that keeps track of student registrations, basically for the banks, to make sure that students aren't obligated to start paying back their loans. The banks work through this clearinghouse of data and check on student enrollment to see that the loans aren't due.
They have a vital concern.
Data are better, I find, when money's concerned. they also provide a service to institutional researchers that allow us to send a file to them, match it against their records, and see how many of students, former CUNY students, are enrolled elsewhere. And so we know, for instance, that somewhere of the entering cohorts for baccalaureate students, somewhere in the order of 15% to 20% will show up as transfers outside the CUNY system going some other place. In the old days, when we did retention statistics, those people looked like failures, like they were dropouts, and they're not. They just chose to go to a different college than CUNY.
They wouldn't show up, however, in these numbers.
No, these are just graduation rates.
For CUNY
only.
We might well have to add 10% to 15% to each of these numbers to get a sense of the extent to which CUNY has been successful, at least to some extent, given while they were here.
Yeah, exactly. And the other thing that's not in these numbers... The other thing that's not in these numbers is the percent at the end of the tracking period who are still enrolled at CUNY and pursuing their degree. So if you track them out 8 years or longer, the graduation rates will rise. And it takes our students longer than it does SUNY students, for instance, nationally to get through to their degrees. And part of the reason is because they have all of these other extracurricular obligations of work and family. And
So we might double these numbers in terms of a rule of thumb?
Yeah, when you add in all of these other, the ultimate graduations and the movement out of the system and possible graduation out there, you get up into the high 50s and low 60% rate. One of the experiences that I had working for the last, for Deputy Chancellor Musiolo a couple of years ago, was that he pushed us to do this kind of thing, to try to see what the true success rate of our students might be, and you get up into numbers that high.
Thank you. If you consider if this student stays the same major, or if they change another major?
Well, that makes a big difference. Something like 15% or 20% of our students change their major every year, and students who change their major make slower degree progress. Not in these data, but it's a definite factor in time to degree.
Does CUNY have a mechanism to kind of exit standard when they're leaving the CUNY to the institution?
We haven't done that routinely. We did one survey a few years ago of students who looked like dropouts, and to ask them why they were leaving, The overwhelming reason was economic. Some of them left for good economic reasons and some for bad. For the good reasons were that they maybe had a job opportunity that they wanted to pursue, and it made more sense to them to do that rather than to stay in school. For bad reasons might be that, let's say they lost the job they had, or somebody got sick and they needed to drop out to take care of that person, or to make money to pay for. So our students are economically fragile, and it doesn't take much to caused them to drop out for a term or two because of those reasons. Health reasons, needing to take care of a dependent, those were other reasons. There was some level of dissatisfaction with CUNY and with our student services or the course availability, and so those were reasons people leave too.
I had a very interesting experience because when I was at the city, I talked to a lot of the it was an alumni association dinner, and I asked people, you know, did they graduate? And they said, no, they didn't graduate. And I said, well, why not? They said, well, we couldn't pass the language proficiency exam. Mm-hmm. They fulfill all the requirements for an engineering degree. They have good jobs because the at that time the people came and recruited them before graduation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And they got jobs, but they didn't have the diploma because they didn't pass the language proficiency. Now that's an observation, you know, or maybe can you look at that at all and say,
yeah,
your graduation is only the ones who got diplomas?
We can look at that. I think what you're talking about probably is the CUNY essay, the writing assessment test.
What you have to pass the language, English language proficiency, and the math too, to get your degree.
And that's not an entry requirement.
Huh?
That's not an entry requirement.
Now an entry
requirement. Change the requirement.
It's the graduation.
It used to be going from 7 to 30 years.
Right. Yeah. 60th credit. It used to be at the
64 credits beyond the
The 60th so credit, you needed to have passed it.
My students have to pass examination and all of those things before they can be admitted to credit-bearing courses.
That's true.
And then at 45 credits, they have to do an essay. They change the requirements, but it's worse. It's not better.
Yeah, you're right. The proficiency exam is now probably plays the biggest role as a gatekeeper midway through a student's career, and that's a fairly substantial essay that they have to write, integrating a long passage and a short passage, and show analytical thinking. There was an 85% pass rate on that test as of the last administration. Gives you a sense of the order of magnitude. Students have three attempts to pass the test.
Yeah, I think
it's credit 45 now, too, which is kind of interesting, because that means it applies equally to the two-year and the four-year diploma, which would suggest that, in fact, the two-year diploma is being discounted a little bit further.
You say you have four-year graduation rates, too?
We do.
Part of the set of tables that we prepared for Dr. Tim.
In that packet that I just gave you. It's in that. But we can track students for as long as 10 years, and we do find that there is still a difference between 6 and 8 year graduation rates. The rates go up several percentage points. Just because it takes our students so much longer to get through. So when the mayor called attention to our two-year graduation rates for associate students and said it's 1.7%, he was being pretty unfair to the university. It would mean that our students would have to take 15 credits a term at the community colleges in order to get through, and it doesn't pay attention to the remedial mission of the schools that allow students to take non-credit coursework to build up their skill level and so on.
We're tougher than St. John's College, too.
Well, we are, as a matter of fact. Yes.
I'm in Bruton College, and there's a scholars program over there. How many Asians are involved in, top-notch, upper echelon programs,
and the Honors College, I think is what you mean. I don't have that number off the top of my head. It's probably a little higher percentage Asian than the general population, is what I would guess. Just guessing.
End the presentation with the degrees granted. We talked a little bit about some of the hurdles that students face, but nonetheless, many of them are successful, And so in the 2001-2002 academic year, this is the number of degrees that were awarded, or that Asian students, I mistyped that. It's not just Asian undergraduates, it's Asian students earned a total of...
interesting, we're undergraduates getting master's
doctorates. Yeah, sorry about that. I'll make some changes there.
It's great inflation.
Yeah. And it's worse. I get an email a day about buying a doctoral degree on the web. I'm sure many of you have seen those emails.
The faculty, or did
it? Oops, okay.
How did you identify Asians in the graduation?
I'm sorry?
How did you identify the Asians in the graduation,
in the degrees? We get data from the colleges that is similar to registration data, only in that it has some of the demographic information. And instead of course registration information, it shows the degree earned and what program the student graduated from and that kind of.
And the other answer to your question is that, you know, students originally provide the information when they apply to the university. They fill out an application form and they self-identify essentially. They have a chance to check off the five major categories, and that information stays with them throughout their record at CUNY. There's very little updating of that information that goes on if, say, to fill in missing information over the course of their academic career. And then when they graduate, it gets attached to the graduation record that the colleges send us.
Does the university follow any of these students after graduation? What do they do with their degrees, or when they're employed?
Yes, as a matter of fact.
You do.
Maybe you want to have us come back and tell you about that.
That would be very
we're just completing a survey of associate and bachelor's degrees recipients across the whole university, and so when we tabulate that, we will know what kind of jobs, how much money, how many stay in the city of New York, after they get their degree, and so on. Well, that's why we did it.
Especially if the numbers are good and they're not inflated.
I want to thank Cheryl.
It's all subject to interest.
The highest truth.
Really, that's...
Have anyone thought of some questions and answers?
Yes. Oh, we've been asking.
Is this available? It's not public information. Is it available in public documents someplace? Is it accessible?
I think so. We probably have to clean this up a little bit.
That's what I was going to say. I'll clean it up before I give you a copy to post.
But we can put it on the institutional research website.
Mm-hmm. We'll put the presentation up on the website, on our website. So for people who missed they'll be able to look at the video tape, and they'll be able to get the sense of it. So, you know, all the more official, you know, data, probably you can get it from Dean Crook and Dr. Littman.
You have PDF.
Yeah.
Knock out a PDF from each one.
Right? Yeah.
You can even add in the one piece of it to now.
You can tell me what you're looking for. What kind of format?
Remind me of a statistic, and then I think I have other contacts. What was the statistic of the Asian students relative to others or overall on having less than $25,000 in income?
There was about a 4 percentage point difference between Asians and students overall. I don't remember the
Asians were lower.
Yeah, they were a little more likely to have less than a $25,000 income. So they were a little more.
54 versus 50.
Here's my thinking. Asian students are poorer than the non-Asian students. And on all of the academic and related matters, they tend to be more like traditional students. So my hypothesis is that CUNY is for them what a state university or a private university is to those who never come to CUNY from the other ethnic groups. And if the income level of the Asian student households rises, I don't think it will. I think the immigration is going to continue, and the immigration is going to keep that overall number down. But if the income level rises, more students will not go to CUNY, more Asian students from New York City will not go to CUNY, will go to CUNY or the privates.
You know, I mean, that was, I think, more true a few years ago than it is now with the Honors College and the improving image of the university. We're finding that we're doing a better job now of competing for the better students, I think even independent of their income. So more students, even though they're able to pay for St. John's or even, you know, the SUNYs, like, we know our biggest competition is St. John's. Students, I think there are a lot of students out there who could pay for any of those schools who are more and more choosing to come here because the image of the university is improving. Our show rates are going up. By that, it's a technical piece of jargon, meaning of the students who apply and who are accepted at CUNY, the percent who choose to come here to our baccalaureate programs has been rising a few percentage points over the last few years. So, and I think the Honors College is part of that, and then just the fact that we're not constantly being beat up in the press the way we were a few years ago has made a difference.
What about the dollar issue, though? I mean, I don't think that, I mean, certainly, I can tell you, many of my students say point blank they are at the MCC because it costs less than Peru.
Yeah.
Last time I heard, the senior colleges are still less costly than the state colleges.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
So I would assume that's supportive of Frank's hypothesis that the dollar cost would keep that number high.
Yeah, I didn't mean to disagree, you know, totally with Frank. I think he's got a point that is any particular community has a rising ability to pay for alternatives that they're more tempted to go elsewhere, and they can because they have the resources they will. But despite, I don't know if that's happening, first of all, as you say, and the data show that we're doing a better job than we used to of attracting students here.
Yeah, it seems to me that, finally, Frank, I totally agree with Frank here. It would be interesting to see over the next 10 years, because as I believe I recall from the data, they're not only lower income, but they're much more dependent on their family income.
That's true.
And as the family income increases, it seems to me the options that the family have for their children will increase. I'm not saying that the CUNY and the honor program, those kinds of things are not attractive, but there are other attractive things out there too.
It'd be interesting to look at a trend line to see if the show rate, particularly in the Asian community, has changed in the last few years, and then track it into the future to see where the more most talented Asian candidates to CUNY are choosing to come here versus other places, and you can break it out by income level and by SAT score.
I'll assume maybe the economy will get better over the next 4 or 5 years.
Is there any way to get access to, like, discussions with extended, extended families and so on? Some of my students, my wife's Chinese, teaching Chinese students in the class I love that, an awful lot of them seem to be sisters, cousins, aunts, etc., living in an extended family situation, which I would think would put greater pressure on financial resources.
Hmm. You know, that's interesting. The one piece of information that I remember from 1995, when students were asked about different sources of support for attending college, Asian students were more likely than any other group to say that they were dependent on their family for economic help while they were going to college. So to the extent that plays into that. I mean, it doesn't really address exactly what you're saying, but it is about as close as I can come with a piece of data to...
That is your next research project.
James, is that why I have a question? If you can do something to add some more questions and you do a survey, you wish to, you could add some other questions, for example.
Yeah, I mean, that's in each survey, we do have a block of questions available that we can change from survey to survey. There's some points that we want to keep comparing, you know, term to term, or from each year to the next. But these surveys that we're doing may well become part of the what we call the executive compensation plan indicators for the CUNY college presidents and their executives, whereby their progress towards certain university goals is evaluated every year. And so, for instance, we'll be taking into account student satisfaction with services as one of those measures going forward. That may be a reason for for doing this the survey more regularly than we have in the past.
I think that based on your presentation, it seems that there is a point that is being raised. It seems that Asian students, they interact a little bit less with their peers. They do their work a little, you know, they consult other students a little bit less than normal, for example. And yet they do much more on by the internet in comparison. Mm-hmm. And so that technology helps to facilitate their involvement with their peers.
Yes.
But at the same time, it seems to point to me that maybe it also reflects a certain need in terms of, say, for Asian students to actually interact more socially, you know, with their peers, physically, you know, rather than just through the medium of the internet.
Mm-hmm.
And so if there is a study that's going to be done on Asian students, I would like to see that, because this is so intertwined with what we are talking about. We always talk about Asian American leadership, and that is a lot of the times we find that Asian students, you know, don't, you know, take the bull by the horn and then try to, like, you know, do things. And so you probably feel much more comfortable, you know, sitting in front of the computer, and then you act out much more. So perhaps, do you think that would be a good topic a discussion? Or?
I think there are a number of different data elements in there that could, you know, get you a little further toward that question. I think there's some interesting findings there. And the differences, there are some differences, you know, that you didn't mention that we talked about, the differences in perceptions of diversity and feeling out of place or not on the campus, that you would want to also take a look there to see, you know, how students, how they perceive themselves. I also believe that, didn't we find that they their aspirations were a little different?
Yeah,
than
you know what, I didn't include that in this presentation, but yeah, one interesting thing we found from the survey results was that the educational aspirations of Asian students were a little bit more modest compared to other students. They were more likely to say, overall, if you just looked at, let's say, students who thought they were going to pursue a bachelor's degree, if you just looked at bachelor's degrees, you would see more Asians are projecting that as their terminal degree. But they're less likely then to say that they'll go on for a master's degree or a PhD. And yeah, that's interesting, because if you look, you know, we didn't present any information about graduate school here, but it would be interesting to make that comparison.
On that, and also surveys that I did, and that is, that doesn't represent lower expectations. It represents greater realism. And a lot of other students from other groups have vaulting ambitions that they will put on the questionnaire about where they think they're going to go.
Yeah, there's a lot of...
And it doesn't match at all with all the other data about them academically.
There's a lot of secondary level information.
For the last 20 years, and I mean, I can cite references to the ERIC database on this one, I think this is something else I can do. And that whole question of expectations is so muddy that I would be very hesitant to put a lot of reliance on that until you really get some serious numbers.
It's interesting, though, just the contrast between expectations and then academic performance, too. And there would be, I think, another study here if you were to compare freshmen to sophomores to juniors to seniors. and look and compare students who's compare grade actual grade point average and academic experience to expectations to see if there might be a relationship there. Do students who do well gain confidence and get higher aspirations or over time or not?
And a lot of what you're talking about goes beyond CUNY. I mean, these are broader cultural themes that are raised. And for those of you who are going to be pursuing research, although we haven't asked all the right questions or all the questions that you want to have answers to, there are databases out there that certainly ask those. I mean, I'm more familiar with the K through 12 kinds of surveys, but the government has lots of data on students in colleges. Baccalaureate and beyond is one data set that
it's been done extensively for two-year colleges. I mean, not tens, hundreds of reports on this in the ARIC database. Mm-hmm. And for just about everyone that you can say that too many expectations, students are being misled, yet another one says, they're doing just dandy. You can't get a clear picture from it. It's
very stressed something, the way that data are presented.
Yeah.
To what extent does it at all reinforce a stereotype of Asians as model minorities?
I mean, I guess this is certainly, it's not all aspects of model, and there are some social...
You think they do better academically? They're slightly above the GPA, 2.9, 2.8. It's interesting the way the data are presented here. And I can understand that maybe Karen Aronson might pick it up that way, but I can see that the New York Post and the Daily News may. Yeah. And I think the presentation of the data, it would be helpful if you do an interpretation that, because that stereotype is around.
What angles would you bring to it that, how would you present it differently?
Yeah, but what pops up right away is, like Frank said, if people prefer, or depend on families. It's an old stereotype. Well, somebody made it because they did this, this, and this. And I'm not knocking the data. I think the data are very interesting and helpful for the interpretation of that data. What it means in the context of it is important, so that it does not, well, maybe other people won't make theirs, but I think you need to be careful about it.
I think James, Professor Lapp here from New York City Tech, he wants to take your data and do more in-depth study and analysis with it, so that he would, consider taking into question this idea about the model minority. But I have a question, and that is, you just raised the question of aspiration, but you did not present it. In other words, you had many more questions and data and so forth that were not presented, which Professor Lapp can eventually look at?
Mm-hmm. Yes, we just scratched the surface. There's much more.
Very good.
How hard is it to come down to your office and muck around?
Pretty hard.
We have to get through the series of locks and chamber doors. And
meet us at the front entrance and see us through with our photo ID. Right.
You'll have to sign in blood to guard the confidentiality of the data.
What do you mean? This is not public?
No, we would make it that. We don't. We would make it anonymous, first of all. So that, but we do share the data with research groups from time to time.
No, one thing I was really thought about is that aging students, many of them don't work. Because I know every students I have, they work.
This is just contrary to
what I know.
Mm-hmm. It definitely differs by college, and that we didn't present a breakdown that way. And we presented the statistic as a percentage who don't work, but more than half do work.
And my 58% do.